Are you guys ready to dive into the Word of Life? So we are in our series titled, I Identify As. And what we're going to talk about this morning is I identify as a child of God. I identify as a child of God. Now, I want to start off with a question. Who here has the perfect family? Anybody have the perfect family? Yes? Okay. Some of y'all are in denial. That's a good place to start. So perfect family means everybody is functional. There are absolutely no black sheep. Everybody gets along, right? Now, general rule, if you don't know who the black sheep are in your family, you are probably the black sheep of your family. Now, the thing about families is that our perception of God, our relationship with God, and even our identity is often shaped by our family experiences. The first institutions that God created were marriage and the family. Guys, biblical, God-honoring marriage, biblical, God-honoring families are things that we must be incredibly intentional to preserve and to protect and to fight for. Because the enemy wants nothing more than to distort God's purpose and plan for humanity. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 27, it says, God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. And God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish, over the sea, over the birds of the heavens, and over every living thing that moves on the earth. God created a man. From that man, he created a woman. And from those two, he created a union of one soul and flesh. And from that union, God told them, now go and have lots of babies and teach them about me and teach them my ways and go and make this whole world a good place like you see in the Garden of Eden. This is what your role is as human beings. God established the nuclear family to accomplish his purpose in the earth. Now, the term nuclear family simply means a husband and a wife living together as loving parents with obedient children. And those obedient children operating as supportive siblings. That is God's perfect plan for humanity. Now, since we've been using the Lion King to give us some examples of what this is supposed to look like, there is a quick clip I want to show you of what the nuclear family looks like. Check this out. Very simple, right? It's not meant to be complicated. You have a mother, you have a father, you have children, and you have them living in loving relationship with each other. But the problem is, life is hard. And sin disrupts God's plan for humanity. And the way that Satan always tries to come in, the first place that Satan came in to attack us was within our families. And so today, the idea of a nuclear family is becoming more and more rare. Because Satan knows that if he can disrupt the nuclear family, he can disrupt God's original mandate and plan for all of us. The nuclear family, the idea of the perfect family, it's great in theory, isn't it? I mean, think about it. Moms, dads, when you're getting ready to bring that baby home for the first time, there's so much excitement. There's so much passion. There's so much anticipation of all these great family moments that you're going to have together until you actually get the baby home, right? So a lot of you know our story. Journey, our oldest, she was born 3 months premature. She weighed 1 pound, 10 ounces. She was a micro preemie. And my wife was actually in St. Louis when she started having complications. So Journey was born in St. Louis. So for 9 weeks, I had to travel back and forth between the church and St. Louis to see Amy and Journey while they were in the hospital there. And Journey was growing and we were getting her ready to bring her home. Well, I remember the excitement and the joy that we had the day we got to bring Journey home. It had been over 2 months of this anticipation of getting to have our family together, to be able to start this life together that we'd been dreaming about for months and months and months. Well, the night before we brought Journey home, I had to, because of their policy, I had to stay at the hospital. And I didn't sleep that entire night. Because it's a hospital room, it's busy, nurses are coming in and out, they're getting Journey ready to go home the next day, and so I didn't get any sleep. Then the next day, it's a whole day, and if you've ever had a preemie and you've brought a preemie home, you've got to have them sit in their car seat for a certain amount of time. There's all these things you have to do to make sure that that baby's ready to go home. And so finally, at the very end of the day, we get to go home, but then we've got a 4-hour car drive back home from St. Louis. And when you've got a micro preemie that you're bringing home, you've got to stop like every 30 minutes to an hour and get them out, and you got to feed them, and you got to move them around. And so what would have been a 4-hour drive home was like a 7.5-hour drive home. And we get home and it's like 11 o'clock at night, and we go upstairs and we've got this plan in our minds, right? Like, we're going to take our baby, we're going to put her in her crib, and she's going to sleep. Except that she didn't know the plan. And so after about 48 hours of zero sleep, and just the stress and the pressure and the exhaustion of getting her home, and then she just starts to scream and scream and scream. I mean, this is a completely new environment for her, right? And I remember at some point in the midst of just that pure exhaustion, looking at my wife and just saying, can we take her back? Just want to sleep. We have these great intentions, but sin often gets in the way of them. In fact, you can look at Genesis chapter 3, verse 16, and you see in this passage the effect that sin has on the family. God says to Eve, I will surely multiply your pain in childbearing. In pain you shall bring forth children. Your desire will be contrary to your husband, and he will rule over you. Now, it's easy to look at this and think that God is being vindictive or vengeful, but in reality, this is what God was trying to protect us from. This is why God did not want us to know sin for ourselves, because we cannot know about sin without trying it out. This is what it means to be human. This is human nature. We have an inclination to do these things that separate us from God and His intention. And because of human sin, now there is a disruption in our relationship with each other. He said the first disruption, and ladies, sorry, but having babies hurts. I've been told. I had a kidney stone once, and then the lady said, shut up, it's still not the same, right? So having babies hurts, and then raising children hurts because there's conflict and there's difficulty and there are no perfect children. But not only that, even the marital relationship has strain because we see things differently. We approach life differently, and we both want our own wills to be done. And so now this perfect family unit that is meant to bring about God's perfect plan gets disrupted, and a mess ensues. And because of that, every single one of us carries scars. Every single one of us carries some kind of a wound, whether it be from a parent or for a sibling. I don't care how great your parents are. All of us make mistakes. My girls are 10 and 6. I have made mistakes. I'm sure someday they're going to be talking to somebody about something dumb that I said or something insensitive that I did that wounded them in a deeply profound way. There's a simple principle found throughout the Bible. If you want God's blessing, do it God's way. Simple enough, right? And today, this is one of the primary reasons why the nuclear family is under such attack. Because we're not doing things God's way. In fact, we have this weird tendency as a culture and as people to try to normalize behavior that God did not intend to be normal because we don't want anybody's feelings to be hurt. Have you noticed this? That we try to normalize things and then we're like, well, it's really not that big of a deal. But it is a big deal. But at the same time, please hear me, there is grace extended, right? I've lived in just about every type of family dynamic. I had the nuclear family for a few years. I've been raised by a single mom. I've lived in blended family units, and I've seen how all three of those different dynamics have their challenges and can have their blessings. None of them are easy, but only one of those is God's purpose and design. However, when we recognize our brokenness before God, we ask Jesus to forgive us, we repent of our sin, then God will extend his blessing even into any of those situations. If you're a single parent in here, if you do it God's way from this way forward, God will bless your household. If you are in a blended family situation and there is repentance and forgiveness and you do it God's way moving forward, God will bless that household. But there's still consequences. It's still not going to be what it could have been, but it is still going to be good because God is good. Amen? However, if we reject God's plan, we set ourselves up for failure. We get so upset and so angry at God when in reality, so much of our problem resides in our own choice. If you are in Christ, you do not have to walk around in shame or in guilt or feeling bad. That's the goodness of Jesus. But we should never stop pursuing God's plan for the next generation. Do you hear me? So if we've messed up, if we haven't done it God's way, we should still actively pursue God's way for our children. And our grandchildren, we should not just make a mistake or make an excuse and say, well, this is just the way we do things. By the way, my grandparents married 3 times. My parents married 3 times. Unless God kills one of us, I'm only going to be married 1 time. Well, I guess I would only be married once if God killed me. So that's the plan, to reverse the curse and to live in the blessing of Jesus. Now, one of the things about kids are absolutely amazing. And one of the things that they're amazing at is kids have this natural openness to the things of God. Have you noticed that? Like, you don't have to convince a 3-year-old that Jesus lives. They just naturally accept and believe. And that's why Jesus goes so far and says that we must accept the kingdom of heaven like little children, because it's an open-hearted acceptance. But children are also easily wounded. And in our developmental stages as kids, we can take wounds that we will carry with us for the rest of our lives. And unfortunately, many of us become disconnected from God because of experiences of pain and brokenness that we have within our own families. And when we are young and we experience this fracturing within our families, we can experience also a fracturing of our identities. This is why you have 60-year-old people walking around still talking about things that happened to them when they were six. And it's not because they didn't just get over it. It's because they didn't experience healing from it. And that's one of the biggest lies that we've even propagated within the body of Christ, that you should just get over things because you're saved. No, now that you're saved, you can receive healing. Now you can actually address the issues that have occurred. But you don't just want to pretend like they're not there. So many of us walk around with scars from our family wounds. Things like neglect, absence, abuse, enabling. You know, enabling leaves scars too. Or maybe you had really awesome parents and you just walk around with a lot of regret because you were a rebellious little jerk. That was me. I was rebellious. There's a story in the Bible that illustrates family wounds really, really well. In the book of Genesis, chapters 37 through 50, we follow the life of a man named Joseph. If you've never read the story of the life of Joseph, I encourage you to do so. It's an incredible story of God's power and redemptive purposes for his people. But in the story of Joseph, you have God's intention for a nuclear family. Joseph's dad was named Jacob. Jacob set out to find a wife. And he met a woman that he fell in immediate love with. And he was even willing to serve for 7 years to earn her hand in marriage. But then, because of family dysfunction, he was tricked into marrying the sister. So what God intended for a nuclear family, one man, one woman for one lifetime, family dysfunction got in the way of that plan. And so now we have an altered plan that Joseph is in. But then, because of family dysfunction and sibling rivalry, two other wives get introduced to the two sisters. And these are servants. Jacob allowed himself to be talked in by the culture that this was going to be a good and acceptable plan. You never see him actually praying about this. Because if you've been married for 5 minutes, you know if your prayers, hey God, multiple spouses, good idea, God's going to be like, no, don't do it. You can't make one person happy. You're going to make multiple people happy, right? This is all it does is breed dysfunction. And just because God doesn't kill you for something doesn't mean that he's applauding you for it. Did you hear that? Just because something is allowed doesn't mean God's like, yeah, good idea. So in the midst of this, Joseph is the second to the last son born, and he's born to the favorite wife. So now there's favoritism. Favoritism always destroys. This favoritism created a little bit of arrogance in Joseph. Probably a naive arrogance. Have you ever been around a favored child before? Like, usually it's the youngest in the family, and they just have no concept of their place. Like, they just think they're the best because they're treated like they're the best, and they just walk around like they can't do anything wrong. Do I have any youngest kids in the building? Yeah? Yeah, we know you. We didn't even have to guess, guys. No, I'm just kidding. So Joseph's naive arrogance toward his brothers creates this jealousy amongst all of the sons of Jacob. And they begin to hate Joseph. And this hatred leads them to a place of abuse. They are willing and desiring to abuse their little brother, which turns into betrayal and abandonment. And Joseph is sold into slavery. Now, I don't know about you, but I can get drawn into the one-up game in families. Like, oh, you think your family's screwed up? I'll see this and I'll raise you this. You guys ever play that game? Yeah. Well, we can play, but I play to win, all right? We all have screwed up families to some point. We all do. We can all point to an uncle or an aunt or a cousin or some or ourselves and show dysfunction. This is a dysfunctional situation. And by all means, Joseph should have been destroyed as a person because of what he was experiencing. I mean, he went from being the favored son to being a slave, to having the brothers that should have been loving and protecting him, selling him, wanting him dead, hating his guts. And the father who loved him more than anything in the world, he was now completely separated from. He was all alone, on his own. But Genesis chapter 39, verse 2 says this: the Lord was with Joseph. The Lord was with Joseph. No matter what you have experienced in your family dynamic, the Lord is always with you. In the midst of abuse, neglect, abandonment, pain, the Lord is still with you. I cannot answer the big question that always arises. I cannot explain why it's allowed, but I do know this. God is big enough and good enough that he will bring good out of any situation if we allow him. Because in Joseph's life, it says the Lord was with him and he became a successful man and he was in the house of his Egyptian master. His master saw that the Lord was with him and that the Lord caused all that he did to succeed. So Joseph found favor in his sight and attended him, and he made him overseer of his house and put him in charge of all that he had. Your family past does not dictate your current and future identity. I don't care if you were raised in absolute poverty, you are not in poverty in the name of Jesus. I don't care if you were raised in horrific abuse, unmentionable abuse, that does not have to continue in your family because of Jesus. I don't care whatever generational issues have come up over and over and over again. They stop with you because you are new in Christ Jesus. And God will give you favor if you recognize that the Lord is with you. Then Joseph gets thrown into prison. He's already a slave, can't get much worse, but now he's thrown into prison based off of false accusations. And in Genesis 39, 21, it says, but the Lord was with Joseph. And he showed him steadfast love. And he gave him favor in the sight of the keeper of the prison. Guys, no matter what Joseph was facing, no matter what situation was in front of him, circumstance he was currently engaged in, the Lord was with him. And even though he was separated from his physical, biological family, from the father that had adored him his entire life, even though he had no family to rely on, his father was with him. And your father is with you. Your father has never left your side. Then Joseph gets the opportunity to interpret Pharaoh's dream. And in Genesis 41, Pharaoh says to his servants, can we find a man like this? And whom is the Spirit of God? Then Pharaoh said to Joseph, since God has shown you all this, there is none so discerning and wise as you are. You shall be over my house, and all my people will order themselves as you command. Only as in regards to the throne will I be greater than you. Guys, I get family wounds. And I could sit down and talk with you about things that I've experienced. And you know what? I had it pretty good. I had it pretty easy compared to a lot of people. There wasn't a lot of horrific abuse in my past. There was a lot of divorce and a lot of the mess that comes with that when I was growing up. But I don't really know abuse. Some of you do. But I can tell you this with full confidence because of what God's word says, that no matter what you have faced from your families, your Lord is with you. And he will prosper you. And he will bless you. But that only occurs when we allow ourselves to be aware that he is with us. Because the temptation is for us to harden our hearts to his nearness and to refuse to accept that steadfast love, because we misinterpret the mistakes and the sin of our family as the intention and plan of God. But that is not true. It was never God's plan, purpose for you to be abused, to be neglected, to be abandoned, to be hurt. That's why Jesus came into the world, because it's broken. And Jesus has never left your world for a moment. The Lord is with you. And if we are willing to accept him in the midst of our brokenness, then he will show up in the midst of our blessing. And he will do it. Despite all of the difficulties of his life, Joseph never lost his identity because he maintained his relationship with the Father. In John chapter 14, verse 18, Jesus makes you a promise. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. I will not leave you as orphans. No matter what your physical reality, there is a spiritual reality that supersedes that in Christ, and that the Holy Spirit is available to every single one of us who would call upon the name of Jesus. And as you call upon the name of Jesus, you become a child of God. And as a child of God, you have certain rights. My daughters have certain rights that other people do not have. My girls can have things from me that nobody else has a right to. But because they are my children and I love them, they have access to me that nobody else gets. You are a child of God if you've called upon the name of Jesus. And you have the rights of protection, presence, provision, and promise. In John chapter 1, verses 12 through 13, Jesus said, but to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of the blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of the will of God. Now hear this, if you receive the promise of Jesus, if you receive the salvation through his life, death, and resurrection, and you believe in his name, you are given the right to become a child of God. Being a child of God is not given to every human being. This is a misconception. Every single human being has value because we are all created in God's image. But to become a child of God, you must go through God's only child. Does that make sense? To have rights to the Father, We have to go through the only begotten Son, Jesus. But with that comes the right of protection. Now, hear me. The right of protection does not mean that nothing bad will ever happen to you. I cannot protect my girls from everything in this world as much as I would love to. Because if I did, I would stifle their growth. I would limit their free will. They would not be able to become who they were supposed to be if I just kept them in a box for safety. Well, God is all powerful. But the Father will not restrict our free will. And because of that, He will not restrict us from experiencing the consequences of sin in this world. But He will still protect us. And the place that God protects is in our minds and in our hearts. Because no matter what we face physically, if our mind and our heart is protected, then we stay strong. Amen? 1 John 3:10. By this it is evident who are the children of God and who are the children of the devil. Whoever does not practice righteousness is not of God, nor is the one who does not love his brother. As a child of God, you have rights to God's presence. And the time that you spend in God's presence will be evident by the way you live your life, because you will produce the fruit from the source you are drawing from. If you are a child of God and you are dwelling in God's presence, you are going to produce righteousness naturally because God is righteous. But there's a wicked stepfather out there. Now, I've been blessed. I've got an amazing stepfather. I love him. I sent him a Father's Day message last night thanking him for everything he's done for me for the last 19 years. But you know what? Some people have experienced really wicked, nasty step-parents. And there's a nasty stepfather out there. And his name's Satan. And he wants to step in and dominate and control. And a lot of us have rejected the loving call of the Father and allowed ourselves to be taken in by the lies and the deception of the enemy. And he does nothing but abuse and distorts our identity. In Galatians chapter 4, verse 5, it says, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of His Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, you are a son. And if you are a son, then you are an heir through God. You have the right of God's provision. The provision of the redemption of your soul from your sin. You are no longer on a course to hell of separation from God for eternity. You are on a course into deeper and deeper relationship with the Father. Because as a child of God, through the Son of God, you have the right of God's provision. And look what it says here. This is not a standoffish relationship. He says he sends the Spirit into our hearts so that we can call him Abba, Father. You know what Abba means? It means daddy. It means daddy. I have two little girls, and I dread the day that they would stop calling me daddy. I don't care if they are 30 years old, married and children, I still want to be daddy. Because that's my heart for them. Because they're my babies. And I love them. But that only comes through intensity of depth, of intimacy and relationship. And that's what the Father wants with you. And that's what you can have. I don't care what your earthly father did. I don't care how much they screwed up. I don't care what your family has said. The mistakes that they've made. Your Father wants to know you. And finally, Romans 8:17. If we are children, then we are also heirs. Heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified with him. As a child of God, you have the right of promise. You have the right of promise. Now, my dad and I, we joke around that the only thing that I'm going to inherit from him is bills. It's not how it is with our Heavenly Father. You don't inherit any debt because Jesus has paid all of your debt. And he's paid all of the debt of all of your family going back all of that time. You don't owe anyone anything except your allegiance to the Father. All of the promises of God's word are yours as his child. If you're willing to receive the offer. But so many of us reject it. So many of us allow the bad family experiences that we have had in this life to prevent us from experiencing the perfect family experience God has for us. And I'm sorry, guys. I'm sorry if you've been hurt. But there's healing for that hurt. But only in the person of Jesus. I came to a realization a number of years ago about my identity. And I just want you to hear this. I got to the place where I was completely frustrated and confused and at a loss for who I was. And so I was going from relationship to relationship, activity to activity, philosophy to philosophy, religion to religion, desperately trying to figure out who I was. And then I met Jesus. And when I met Jesus, this became my prayer. I simply said, Jesus, I do not know who I am, but I know you are I am. I don't know who I am yet, but I know that you are the I am. And that's a place for me to start. Because it is only by discovering who God is that you can discover who you are. You will only find your identity by surrendering to the person, the work, and the love of God's Son. And if you're willing to do that, if you're willing to ask Jesus to forgive you of your sins, if you're willing to acknowledge that Jesus lived perfectly, died on the cross, and rose victoriously from the dead, and if you're willing to say, Jesus, my life is yours, you are Lord, I surrender, then you get to become a child of God. And as you become a child of God, you have the rights of protection, presence, provision, and promise. Let's pray. Father, I identify as your child. Not because I did it. Not because I even wanted it. But because you love me. And because Jesus sacrificed himself, gave himself for me. So it is by the life of your only begotten Son that I am now adopted with full rights into your family. God, that makes you so worthy of my worship. That makes you so worthy of my allegiance. That makes you so worthy of my gratitude. Happy Father's Day. Abba, Daddy, thank you for loving us. In Jesus' name. Would you stand and worship the Father with me?